And yet another very wonderful evening out there to all of you, my dear friends. We left off in our last Bible study in Isaiah 17 with the judgment upon the attacking Assyrian army. Now we pick up in a very mysterious chapter. It's referring to Ethiopia right down here. Woe to the land shadowing with wings, which is beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. In the days of Isaiah, Ethiopia was a major world power, ruling Egypt and a chief rival to Assyria. Since Judah was caught in the middle of this conflict, it might make sense in the worldly sense for Judah to align herself with Ethiopia against Assyria. But once again, woe to Ethiopia, that sendeth ambassadors by the sea, even in vessels of bulrushes upon the waters, saying, Go, ye swift messengers from Ethiopia, to a nation scattered and peeled, to a people terrible from their beginning hitherto, a nation meted out and trodden down, whose land the rivers have spoiled. Who are these ambassadors? Well, of course, messengers sent to Jerusalem at that time that negotiations passed between Tirhaka and Hezekiah, the king of the Jews, against the expected attack of Sennacherib, the king of the Assyrians. All ye inhabitants of the world and dwellers on the earth, see ye when he lifteth up an ensign on the mountains, and when he bloweth the trumpet, hear ye. For so the Lord said unto me, I will take my rest, and I will consider in my dwelling place like a clear heat upon herbs, and like a cloud of dew in the heat of harvest. These words paint with marvelous vividness the calmness and deliberation of the workings of divine judgments. God is at once unhasting and unresting at the same time. He dwells in his resting place, palace or throne, and watches the ripening of the fruit which he is about to gather. For afore the harvest, when the bud is perfect and the sour grape is ripening in the flower, God shall both cut off the sprigs with pruning hooks and take away and cut down the branches. They shall be left together unto the fowls of the mountains and to the beasts of the earth, and the fowls shall summer upon them, and all the beasts of the earth shall winter upon them. The prophet means that when everything respecting the Assyrians was in the most promising situation, when Sennacherib's great designs seemed almost mature and just ready to be crowned with success, his mighty efforts should be in a moment frustrated, his vast expectations rendered abortive, and the chief part of his immense army made a prey to the beast and birds, which they were. The 185,000 died in one night. He lost his entire army that he had such great confidence in one night. In that time shall the present be brought unto the Lord of hosts, of a people scattered and peeled, and from a people terrible from their beginning hitherto, a nation meted out and trodden underfoot, whose land the rivers have spoiled, to the place of the name of the Lord of hosts, the Mount Zion. Now what's believed about this present being brought to Jerusalem is that Ethiopia shall then pay homage to the true God on that day, because they'll see this, and everyone in the world will hear about this great thing that happened right outside the walls of Jerusalem. There's no mistaking that God did this. There's no other way. This army was the most unbeatable army in the entire world, probably the greatest army that had ever been assembled at that time in the history of the world. And suddenly it's before the walls of Jerusalem, and in one night they all just die. There's only just a few scattered, and they're left to go and tell everyone else what happened. Devastating. What a momentous occasion. Ethiopia shall then pay homage to the true God at Mount Zion, Jerusalem, the earthly seat of his sovereignty. Now for chapter 19, the burden of Egypt. So we was talking about Ethiopia, now we move right upwards to Egypt. The burden of Egypt. Behold, the Lord rideth upon a swift cloud and shall come into Egypt, and the idols of Egypt shall be moved at his presence, and the heart of Egypt shall melt in the midst of it. The idols shall be moved at his presence. And I will set the Egyptians against the Egyptians, and they shall fight every one against his brother, and every one against his neighbor, city against city, and kingdom against kingdom. And the spirit of Egypt shall fail in the midst thereof, and I will destroy the counsel thereof. And they shall seek to the idols, and to the charmers, and to them that have familiar spirits, and to the wizards. In Isaiah's day, there was no other nation on earth that was so much in the grip of superstition and filthy idolatry as Egypt. Apes, cats, frogs, crocodiles, lizards, everything was venerated by them. And the Egyptians will I give over into the hand of a cruel lord. And a fierce king shall rule over them, saith the Lord of hosts. And the waters shall fail from the sea, and the rivers shall be wasted and dried up. And they shall turn the rivers far away, and the brooks of defense shall be emptied and dried up. The reeds and flags shall wither. The paper reeds by the brooks, by the mouth of the brooks, and everything sown by the brooks shall wither, be driven away, and be no more. The sense is not doubtful here. It means the rivers shall become putrid, or have an offensive smell. That is, shall become stagnant, and send forth unwholesome pollution, producing sickness, as stagnant waters often do. And we know that that happens in the latter days, during the time of God's wrath. Remember wormwood? How it poisons all these waters, and then you have another one that attacks just the fresh waters. And it probably happened back then as well for a time. The fishers also shall mourn, and all they that cast angle into the brook shall lament, and they that spread nets upon the waters shall languish. Moreover, they that work in fine flax, and they that weave networks shall be confounded, and they shall be broken in the purposes thereof, all that make sluices and ponds for fish. Surely the princes of Zoan are fools. The counsel of the wise counselors of Pharaoh has become brutish. How say ye unto Pharaoh, I am the son of the wise, the son of ancient kings? Where are they? Where are thy wise men? And let them tell thee now, and let them know what the Lord of hosts hath proposed upon Egypt. The princes of Zoan are become fools, and the princes of Noph, Memphis, are deceived. They have also seduced Egypt, even they that are of the stay of the tribes thereof. The Lord hath mingled a perverse spirit in the midst thereof, and they have caused Egypt to err in every work thereof, as a drunken man staggereth in his vomit. Notice how the Lord sends a perverse spirit among them to cause confusion. To bring Egypt into so distracted a state, the hand of God had been necessary. He had introduced into the nation a spirit of perverseness. Those in whom this spirit was had then led Egypt astray in all her doings. The Lord can do that with any nation, mind you. I believe that he's doing that with America. Long-continued success and prosperity produces often a sort of intoxication in a nation. Neither shall there be any work for Egypt, which the head or tail, branch or rush may do. In that day shall Egypt be like unto women, very fearful of what they see. And it shall be afraid and fear because of the shaking of the hand of the Lord of hosts, which he shaketh over it. And the land of Judah shall be a terror unto Egypt. Everyone that maketh mention thereof shall be afraid in himself because of the counsel of the Lord of hosts, which he hath determined against it. Now, everyone pay attention to these words that are coming up. In that day shall five cities in the land of Egypt speak the language of Canaan, of the promised land. It's quite strange. And swear to the Lord of hosts. One shall be called the city of destruction. No one, as Bishop Loth justly observes, can pretend to determine what the city was that is here mentioned by name, much less to determine what the four other cities were which the prophet does not name. I take the whole passage from the 18th verse to the end of the chapter to contain a general intimation of the future propagation of the knowledge of the true God in Egypt and Syria under the successors of Alexander, which would have been many hundreds of years later. And in consequence of this propagation of the early reception of the gospel in the same country, so this also has a much broader, as just with almost every prophecy in these prophets, it has this buildup of fulfillments. There's this immediate, and then another one. So this also may be pointing to the gospel being spread into Egypt when it should be published to the world. But now let's just go just another verse on in and see if we can get a little bit more clarification. I believe this is fairly important, and it's also historical how this has at least been partially fulfilled. Isaiah 19:19, in that day shall there be an altar to the Lord in the midst of the land of Egypt, and a pillar at the border thereof to the Lord. Now, so many believe that this is referring to the pyramid in Egypt. how this will be dedicated to God or so. It's always been dedicated to false idols, though. I believe that there's a much more ironclad historical thing that was built around 150 BC. After the Maccabean revolt and Antiochus Epiphanes had desecrated the temple in Jerusalem, this right here happened. In consequence of wars between the Jews and Syrians, Onias IV, the high priest, fled to Alexandria. This Jew high priest fled to Alexandria in Egypt, where on account of his active sympathy with the cause of Egypt against Syria, he was welcomed by Ptolemy Philometor and rewarded by being made prince over the Jews in Egypt. About 154 BC, with the permission of Ptolemy, he built at Leontopolis a temple, which, though comparatively small, was modeled on that of Jerusalem and was called by the name of its founder, Onias. Onias doubtless expected that after the desecration of the second temple by Antiochus Epiphanes, after that, by the Syrians, the Egyptian temple would be regarded as the only legitimate one. But the traditional teachings of Judaism, as contained in the Mishnah, concede no legitimacy to the temple of Onias. In fact, even for the Egyptian Jews, the latter did not possess the same importance as did the temple of Jerusalem. According to Josephus, the temple of Leontopolis existed for 343 years, though the general opinion is that this number must be changed to 243. Now pay close attention. This really struck me. I was like, what in the world? He relates that the Roman emperor Vespasian feared that through this temple, Egypt might become a new center for Jewish rebellion, and therefore ordered the governor of Egypt. Vespasian ordered the governor of Egypt, Lupus, to demolish this temple. Lupus died in the process of carrying out this order, and the task of stripping the temple of its treasures, barring access to it, and removing all traces of divine worship at the site was completed by his successor, Paulinus, which dates the event to August 73 AD. So that really is striking, because just a couple of years after the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed, so was this temple in Egypt destroyed. You all rejected your God. You rejected your king. Therefore, no place will be where you can worship anymore, not even this one in Egypt. And I do believe that it's possible that this temple is going to be rebuilt, just as the third temple in Jerusalem is going to be built in these last days. There's a reason for that, because in the very next verse we read, and this place, this altar in Egypt, will be for a sign and for a witness unto the Lord of hosts in the land of Egypt. For they shall cry unto the Lord because of the oppressors, and he shall send them a savior and a great one, and he shall deliver them. And the Lord shall be known to Egypt, and the Egyptians shall know the Lord in that day, and shall do sacrifice and oblation. Yea, they shall vow a vow unto the Lord and perform it, and the Lord shall smite Egypt. Remember how he says he'll send plagues to them during the millennial reign? This is obviously speaking about the millennial reign. And he shall smite and heal it, and they shall return even to the Lord, and he shall be entreated of them and shall heal them. In that day shall there be a highway out of Egypt to Assyria, and the Assyrian shall come into Egypt, and the Egyptian into Assyria, and the Egyptian shall serve with the Assyrians, meaning that there'll be peace among the people. In that day shall Israel be the third with Egypt and with Assyria. There'll be peace among all them. Even a blessing in the midst of the land, whom the Lord of hosts shall bless, saying, blessed be Egypt, my people. Isn't that remarkable? Blessed be Egypt, my people, and Assyria, the work of my hands. That is so lovely. Because we read about how they're enemies of the Lord the whole time, and now he calls them his people. That is just so lovely. And Israel, mine inheritance. Now that is such an excellent way for us to leave off this study, my friends. I thank you all for joining me. What a remarkable ending to the story of this earthly life, isn't it? But the Lord makes everything lovely, doesn't he? Thank you all for joining me once again, my dear friends. Lord willing, we're going to be getting into Isaiah 20 here very soon. God of peace, love, and mercy be with you. Amen.